Good afternoon, everyone. This is Victoria Pebbles at the Great Lakes Commission, and with me is Dan Gold. This is the final advisory group webinar for the Erie P Market Project, and thanks to those who could join us today for the webinar. We are recording today's webinar so we can post it and share it with members of the advisory group that couldn't join today. And normally Nicole Zaccardo would be presenting this, but she was called away unexpectedly for a family matter. So you've got Dan and I. So we're going to walk through what we've been doing for the past couple of years as we wrap up this project. So what was the motivation for the project? Just by way of reminder, we were asking ourselves the question about, can water quality help address nutrient pollution in the Western Basin to prevent harmful algal blooms during the late summer months? I mean, most of you who serve on this group know that the harmful algal blooms in Western Basin are a problem that have been exacerbated in the last decade, and reducing the nutrient loadings into the Western Basin is a strategy for reducing those harmful blooms. So how do we want to do that? With this project, we wanted to build a consistent approach for how you could do water quality trading in the Western Basin. And we're calling that the framework, and we'll talk about that a little bit more. And this is really the first time a multi-jurisdictional approach was taken for water quality trading. There have been other in the Great Lakes Basin, there have been other programs trying to get trading off the ground in the basin. The Lower Fox River effort called Fox P Trade a few years ago, which preceded the Erie P Market, looked at it, and there have been a few others as well. It's important to note that the other multi-jurisdictional trading effort was outside of the Great Lakes Basin, and that's in the Ohio River Basin project. And we were happy to be able to build on and leverage some of the lessons learned from that effort. So we were looking at the states of Michigan, Indiana, and Ohio, with Ontario as an observer. Like, can we get all of them on the same page with how trading would work for the Western Basin? And then, can we test that framework and to see if it works through pilot trades? And then consider how we can take the results from this work to bring it forward for other phosphorus or nutrient reduction efforts. So we originally envisioned this project to support compliance trades. This would mean that the buyers of water quality credits would be permit holders, typically those that hold on the U.S. side NPDES permits for wastewater treatment facilities. So instead of putting brick and mortar technology upgrades at the sort of end of pipe, they could take those investments instead and give them to a agricultural producer upstream that will reduce the same amount. And there are a number of states that allow that in the Great Lakes region, so we were looking at that as a potential mechanism for this trading market. Again, a cost-effective option for these NPDES permit holders. But when we did a demand analysis, actually, and when I say we, I would like to acknowledge on our team, we had the Kaiser & Associates as our technical consultant. And many of you in past webinars heard presentations from them on some of the reports and work that they've done for this project. So the demand analysis that K&A did really showed us that there wasn't a lot of compliance drivers. There weren't pressure being put on these facilities where they thought, I really want to be looking at alternative compliance measures as opposed to upgrades at my plant or my facility. And there are a variety of reasons for that, but I'm not going to go into details today. They are in this report, which is on the website, and I'll provide a link at the end of the webinar if you want to dig into that. But I think we've covered that in previous webinars. So what we did is we started to pivot in the last, like, around about a year ago, and we realized we wanted to look at the framework to see how could it also support stewardship trades. And this is the same idea. You have a buyer and a seller, and you have a credit, but rather than making that credit hinge upon or be attached to a permit, anybody could buy it. So these could be an individual organization like an NGO, it could be a philanthropy, it could be an individual. So how did we go about quantifying load reductions? So this is a schematic on the left that kind of walks you through how we try to do that, because one of the things that we've seen in a number of trading programs across the country is that the question of how phosphorus load reductions or any kind of ecological benefit is quantified and turned into a credit really becomes a sticking point for many of these markets. As people really who are buying them, they say, well, how do I know? Do I really know that what I'm buying or what I'm paying for is having this reduction? And especially if you're buying them before the practices are installed, then you may or may not have confidence that those practices or activities, excuse me, are actually resulting in those load reductions. So many of you by now in this advisory group know that trading, water quality trading and crediting is predicated on modeling. And then you do a verification process to validate that the practices that are modeled are actually installed.
I'm sorry, just a technical note there for people who are viewing our screen. Can you still see our screen? Oh, okay. All right. Just a problem on our end, but sorry
Thank
about
you.
that.
Thanks, Dan. So yeah, you're not unmuted. This is a small group, so pipe in at any time if you have questions, comments, what have you. So what we did here is we tried to look at what are the tools out there that are available to help us calculate phosphorus load reductions. And there were a number of them that were dealing with total phosphorus, but there weren't a lot on the books dealing with dissolved reactive or soluble reactive phosphorus. And we ended up using a combination of the Region 5 spreadsheet, which is US EPA Region 5, which is a pretty coarse model. And then we were able to use this other, we call it the WLEB, the Western Lake Erie Basin Dissolved Reactive Phosphorus Calculator. It was an adaptation that we made from a tool that was originally developed in Pennsylvania to really try to get at the dissolved fraction. It didn't cover all of the dissolved fraction, but it did allow us to at least capture some of it into the modeling effort. And again, that work was done a lot of that work was done by our technical advisors at Kaiser and Associates. So you take the circle on the top and the bottom, the orange circles, the calculations of total phosphorus and the DRP fraction, and you add them together and you get your total pounds per year. And then the arrows show if you want to do a compliance trade, it's up toward the right. And there we said, because of the uncertainties with the model, just safe to say, use a 3-to-1 ratio. If your modeling says you're going to reduce 90 pounds of phosphorus, you would get 30 credits. So that allows us to be very conservative and to virtually guarantee that you're actually achieving those water quality benefits. We didn't propose that kind of trade ratio for the stewardship credit, that's a decision that we made because it wasn't predicated on a compliance market. But you could apply a trade ratio to stewardship if you wanted to. So that's how the credit calculation worked. So this is a way of paying for performance. You're actually basing the credit and the value of the credit on the amount of phosphorus that is reduced. And one of the things that we ended up working with our technical consultant, Kaiser and Associates, also was to compare this tool that we use for Erie P Market with another tool that has been developed by U.S. Department of Agriculture, but has been kind of not wasn't really ready for use in the region, but it became available around the time when we were developing our tool for Western Lake Erie. So Kaiser and Associates did a comparison, and what we found was that the NTT, the nutrient tracking tool, was quite a bit more conservative in their outputs. But if you want to dive into more of that, we can answer questions on that. But that's just many of you might recall that we presented some detail on that early on. So, what do we do with the project? So, a few deliverables. We did design this framework, and in order to make the framework kind of have some legs and some regional legitimacy, we pursued the framework to get signatures by directors from the relevant state agencies. So, in each case, we looked to get a signature from the head of the Department of Agriculture, their equivalent title, and the head of the Water Quality Regulatory Agency. The names vary from state to state. And we did succeed in getting the state agency leads from from Michigan, Indiana, and Ohio to sign on the framework through an MOU about a year ago now. So we're really Again, I mentioned Ontario participating as an observer, as this was a project that was funded from the U.S. Department of Agriculture. And so the framework itself just outlines who is eligible, what are the practices that can be used to generate credits, where and when trading can occur. And that was really important in a multi-jurisdictional framework because we're looking at the end point and the beneficiary being Lake Erie. And so we had to really look at that and how we set up our calculations. And finally, a verification process to ensure that there were positive water quality outcomes. So you do the selling of the credits, you verify the do the modeling, you set up the documents, you contract with the trade, but that somewhere along the way, someone has to actually go out and verify that the cover crop or the no-till was actually performed or the buffer strip was installed. So, in terms of project deliverables, we have fact sheets for buyers and sellers. So, if you are interested in purchasing or you're interested in selling credits, we develop these. We think they're kind of simplified and slick ways to describe credit trading because it can be a very complicated process for those who are new to it. We developed that, as I mentioned previously, this supply and demand report that was led by our technical consultant. And a cross-cut analysis, and this is really a look at what all the jurisdictions in the Western Basin were doing with respect to water quality. That actually we did pretty early on to kind of get a lay of the land about what is Michigan doing with water quality trading, what's Ohio doing, and there was a patchwork of both rulemaking and legislation or non-legislatively mandated programs and activities going on in the states and province. So we really wanted to kind of, the framework tried to even that out, if you will, to provide a common ground despite the differences in individual state and provincial policy. And then we also developed some templates for the applications and contracts so that for each step in this trading process, there were a series of documents that go along with each step. With that, I'm going to pass it over to Dan Gold to talk about our piloting the framework.
Thanks, Victoria. So that was a retrospective overview of kind of the arc of our project. And then, of course, one of our objectives was to actually implement the framework through pilot trade. So I'm just going to go over how that panned out. And once we had our MOU signed, we had our framework, we had five people officially apply to be credit producers. That's ag producers in the Western Lake Erie Basin. And so we did our entire calculation scheme for all five of them. And in the end, we only ended up signing three contracts out of those applications. And that was kind of one of our big lessons learned, or something I guess we had anticipated we would be testing. But the two who decided to not participate in signed contracts, we offered them, it was a pretty low offer, especially compared to EQIP or other ag incentive programs. And basically it was because it's kind of a natural end of a pay-for-performance market that higher priority land is going to get a much bigger bang for your buck with for a given set of BMPs. So in these two locations, we found through our modeling that putting in their BMPs, it wasn't really going to reduce very much phosphorus. So we said, you can go ahead and do it and we'll support it, but we were only going to give you a couple $100. So they said, no thanks. But for three out of the five, we were able to make a pretty substantial offer, which was on par or maybe even a little bit higher than what EQIP would have given them. So those, for the three contracts that went through, they were in Ohio and Michigan. And in Ohio, one of the con or two of them were in Ohio in Fulton County, and one of them was on land that the farmer owned, and the other one was for land that the farmer was leasing. So it was just kind of another little interesting nuance of the contracting to get an additional signature and an additional player on board for the agreement, that being the land owner in this case. So we kind of got to test both of those scenarios. And then for our verification services, We worked out a deal independently with the county conservation districts. We signed a second contract with Fulton County Conservation District in Ohio and then Lenawee County Soil and Water Conservation District in Michigan, where they agreed to verify the initial installation and then for the long-term practices to do an annual inspection once a year to make sure that the practices stay in place for the length of the contract. And here's a little sign on the left. Our grant recipient in Fulton County, they made a nice little sign that they put out next to their filter strip to advertise it. And then the diagram on the right is kind of just a simplified breakdown of this process from application to implementation. So, what did all these contracts say? In the end, we installed a grassed waterway, we installed a filter strip, we put in several hundred acres of cover crops, and we also incentivized one farmer in Michigan to carry out no-till. And so this picture on the right is actually, it's our Fulton County site, and that is, it's our partner there. He used a drone to take that picture, so we thought it was pretty nice. And you can see where what was actually incentivized there. And so, what was the result of putting in all of these BMPs? So we are 536 acres of agricultural land were placed in conservation overall. For several of those acres, they were, multiple BMPs, pretty much cover crops. I would say 536 acres of cover crops went in, and then portions of those acres all were serviced by the other BMPs that we were listed. And by putting those 536 acres into conservation, our modeled outcome shows that across the next 5 years, about 1,200 pounds of total phosphorus, that's particulate and dissolved, will be prevented from entering tributaries to the Western Lake Erie Basin. And here's a photo for Michigan. Let's see, that was the grass waterway that we put in and an erosion control structure. And we didn't actually directly incentivize the erosion control structure, but that was just an additional BMP that the farmer was putting in as part of his work. And I'm just going to check again because we're seeing something strange on our screen, but is everybody still seeing our projection okay?
Yes, we are, Dan.
Yes.
Okay,
Yep.
great. And I also wanted to note that, as many of you know, we've been working with Salford Equipment, and they very graciously volunteered from the get-go with this project to let anybody who participates use their equipment to install the BMPs free of charge. And in the end, Salford did supply equipment for one of the sites in Ohio to put in cover crops. And so there's a photo of that happening in the field. And we were trying to find ways to focus. I could have cut off the picture differently. We don't want the iconic John Deere tractor to dissuade from the beautiful red Salford equipment that we're very thankful for the use of. So now that we've done all of that, where are we now? The Great Lakes Commission, in order to get these BMPs into the ground and with our time limitations, we stepped up with remaining grant funds from NRCS SIG, and we act as the interim buyer of the credits. So in doing that, so we purchased them and we paid the farmers, and we're holding on to the credits. And at this point, we're now seeking individuals or organizations who are interested in purchasing them. And as we said before, since we opened this up into being a stewardship market, it could literally be anybody, any individual, organization, or business who is interested. And we set the price at $30 per credit, where one credit equals 1 pound of total phosphorus prevented from entering the WLEB. And we had our process for determining that price. We talked with the counties where we were contracting with people, and we started by saying, what do you we with the Soil and Water Conservation Districts, what do you guys think these producers would expect to get from other programs to kind of make a baseline. We also looked at the pricing structures for equip in those areas. And then we tried to also model our own costs a little bit. And we wanted to make sure that we could have they were we were selling them for the right price so that we would have money to cover the overhead for future iterations of this project. So we landed on $30. And then in November, we did have our first successful credit sale. And that was after we did a kind of minor media blitz. We put out a press release and we advertised on Great Lakes Commission social media. So we had somebody reach out to us pretty immediately. And it was actually a woman living in Minnesota whose grandson lives in Ohio. And she wanted to purchase one of these credits for his 8th birthday. So we thought that was a nice little story. And we've had several other people reach out to us inquiring about credits, but at this time we've only completed that one transaction. And so now I'll just put out our first plug here that eriepmarket.org. It's linked to the rest of our GLC EREP page, but that's where you can go if anybody here is interested in purchasing credits, or if you want to blast this out to any of your colleagues or anybody who might want to purchase. EREPmarket.org is where they can go to do that or to learn more about the project.
Yeah, so thanks, Dan. I think I'll just stop there and sort of ask you if you have any questions about what we did, and then we're going to just talk about some lessons learned and what we're hoping to do next, building on those lessons learned. But let's just take a moment. We've summarized a lot of information that we've been doing over the past almost 2 years. So, any questions or comments?
Just one question. It's Sarah Rang here from Great Lakes St. Lawrence Cities Initiative. You mentioned that you had actually got about 1,200 pounds of total phosphorus removal over 5 years. Is that a per year figure or is that over 5 years?
That's total across 5 years. Although our modeling did show us year by year how much was attributed to each BMP, but that's the total.
Okay, thanks so much.
Are there other
Hey Dan, it's
questions?
sorry, I had just had a question. It's Jessica Fox from EPRI. I just wondered on your credit sales, you mentioned that you were basically purchasing the credits and putting them in your name, and then once you sell them to another buyer, it would transfer to them. Are the credit sales happen after you install the project? Or do you project out what you anticipate being installed and you sell those units up front?
So for this pilot phase, we did purchase it up front with the hope that we would attract buyers. And I think we kind of talked about it being sort of a revolving fund where we had this initial infusion from the SIG grant. But theoretically, if we could sell all $30,000 or so dollars worth of credits that we fronted the money for, the idea would be that we could use that to front money to more farmers or producers who wanted to put money in. So I guess our structure is that we pay first and find buyers later. That's still something that we've been kind of discussing.
And that's a great
But do
question.
you generate the credits first and then you verify the projects? Or what's the sequence on the credit generation and verification side?
We didn't tell anybody that we had credits for sale until all the BMPs were in the ground and had been verified. Does that answer your
Okay.
question?
Yes, thank you.
Okay.
Are there other questions or comments? So I guess just, some of these questions are asking about the nuances and the details of the transactions. And, we're trying it a different way. I mean, ideally, we would have had buyers lining up that we would have known to, ready to go. And that may have, changed the order in which things occurred in the transaction. But as we talked about, there was not a compliance driving market. And we were under a timeline to complete the work on the project. So it ended up kind of driving us into generating the credits and then selling them as Dan described.
Yeah, I agree. I think that ideally what could have happened is if some large entity came in and said, we want to put down $30,000, what can we get for it? And then we could have reached out to farmers and said, we have all of this money available, what can you do on your field? But as Victoria said, just to accommodate the timeline of this project, we had to move things along more quickly and we had the resources to do it. So that was the main driver for why things happened in the order that they did for this pilot.
So a lesson learned, and to folks like you, Jessica Fox, and others who've been playing in the trading space and for a while, you'll know that the desire to keep the process simple is still a lesson learned. So it is a complex process, but we try to simplify it as much as possible, like with those fact sheets that sort of walk you through with an infographic, like what the steps are. Having templates available ready to go. Here's what a contract looks like. Here's what a verification services agreement looks like. Here's simple ways that you can show people how the calculation is done, what it might be. I think another lesson for us is that, and this kind of came out of some work we did previously in the Lower Fox River in Wisconsin that drains into Green Bay, is that you can get really detailed with your modeling to try to capture all the nuances of everything that's going on in a watershed. And we've looked at lots of different models, and they have their strengths and weaknesses. But what we have, our takeaway is that that doesn't really, as long as you build confidence, whatever model it is, you can offset the lack of certainty with the model by having higher trade ratios. And our experience also shows that even more detailed models aren't necessarily more accurately conveying everything that's going on in the landscape because you're talking about a dynamic ecosystem. So like rainfall events or things like that. So by simply saying, okay, we're going to run this model, it's a simple model, but we're going to do 3-to-1 across the board with a trade ratio, that just keeps it very simple. And people generally understand that, right? The model said 90 pounds, but I'm going to give you 30 credits. And they don't need to dig in and understand the model very they can, but and then the second point is outreach to build confidence. It kind of relates to the first. It's like so whatever model you choose, you're going to need to work with the stakeholders, both the buyers, the sellers, as well as the nonprofit groups and others to so they're confident in what the calculation methods are. Not in their perfection necessarily, but just knowing at least what are the assumptions that went into them, what are the strengths and weaknesses, and the reason that that particular method is being used. Finally, understanding who plays the different roles and having somebody who is a trusted entity that can broker the conversation between a buyer and a seller, and that is known to bring do the calculations the way that the model was designed and compile all the paperwork that needs to be done in a way that makes it simple and have confidence in that. So making sure you put your whoever that is out there, and in this case for this pilot, it was us as that broker. And as Dan mentioned, we worked with the Soil and Water Conservation Districts to be the verifier. And then finally, sort of this potential conflicts between the verifiers and credit sellers. I think that's about, you would. As long as we're doing verification that's field level, that it's actually boots on the ground, people walking onto farms, the desire is, well, who is already trusted and allowed to walk on a farm and talk to a farmer or take pictures? Well, oftentimes that is the Soil and Water Conservation Districts or but at the same time, there are some people will say, well, those folks are very, very close with the farmers. They may or may not be as critical and as judicious in evaluating and verifying practices. And so we've heard this concern. I don't know that there's any validity to it, but there's perception there, and the perception can drive reality. So it's a lesson learned that we felt we wanted to at least share with you all. And for example, in the Lower Fox, when we set up the trading framework there, we ended up bringing in spot verification by the state regulatory body, which is the DNR, designing the program so that they would kind of do a random audit. So that was one way to build confidence that verification was occurring appropriately. Another lesson that we learned, I mentioned this previously, there are weak compliance markets in our binational Great Lakes and even on the US side, in the Great Lakes side, and that sometimes regulators are wary of modeled outcomes. It's not, models can be, as I mentioned, very technical, very detailed, and some of the regulators work at a different in a different space, and diving into all the nuances of a technical model can be confusing and frustrating, and sometimes it's not clear to them how the models result in the outputs and outcomes that they do. On the flip side to that, however, I think we believe that there's an untapped opportunity for stewardship marketing. And this is really thinking about those entities that don't hold a permit, or they may hold a permit, but not necessarily. Let's open up the broader world of folks who are just want to see improved water quality and have something to contribute to that. And this could be philanthropy. It could be individual philanthropist, or it could be a philanthropic organization like a foundation. Could be a drinking water utility. Hey, I'm going to invest in upstream conservation, not for their permit, but because they realize it's going to put less burden on their facility to have to clean up those inputs downstream. And others, like land trusts, for example, where they are governed by board of directors who are investing in land conservation because they want the ecological benefits that come from land conservation, one of which is that the land helps to produce cleaner water. And finally, corporate sustainability programs. So these are programs increasingly popular among the private sector business community, and they set goals for corporate sustainability, and we think there's an opportunity to bring these stewardship credits to that market. So next steps. We would like to apply this basic framework to an environmental credit or ecosystem service stewardship market that serves the basin, creating simple paths for both local and private sector investment in upstream nutrient control through an online marketplace where we buy and sell, where people can buy and sell water quality credits. This is a vision. It's not in practice. We aren't doing it yet. It's something that we would like to do. We think we have all the transactional mechanisms set in place. There's certainly a whole body of work that would still need to be done in order to create that online marketplace. That create that as some of you know, that's a no small feat in and of itself. And also to confirm that our sort of assumption is right, that there are people out there and entities out there that want to buy water quality credits or environmental ecosystem services that are not permit holders. And the reason, what's driving us as well, as I said many times, there aren't compliance drivers. So if we're going to try to use this framework, the real logical next step is to use it outside of the regulatory system. And up here in the second to last bullet, we said when we've been doing some outreach and talking to some of our stakeholder groups, it comes up often that the major issue that people worry about in our region is the impacts from nutrient pollution on Great Lakes waters. So it's something people care deeply about and want to see improved. And finally, municipal water managers have expressed interest in building stronger relationships with their upstream ag neighbors. You're seeing this in other parts of the country, but we think that those interests have not been able to be fully realized because the tools for them to do that haven't been developed and brought to them. And we think we can help, we do have a suite of tools, and we can help bring tools to those managers in our region. So, more next steps? So we're thinking about some potential partnerships, and we have a list of folks up at the top of this slide. It's not an exhaustive list. It's just a starting point for where, if we were to compile a group of people to work with and move forward on a next phase of this, who would we start talking to? Ag producers, of course, municipal water suppliers, municipal water users, downstream self-supplied users, conservation-minded businesses and philanthropy. What are the potential funding sources? So RCPP, this is the Regional Conservation Partnership Program under the U.S. Farm Bill, is a potential source. We've seen that used with in a similar context working with utilities connecting upstream and downstream in other parts of the country. The Great Lakes Protection Fund, I put that in here. We haven't talked to them about this yet, but they are very interested in ecosystem service markets, and then other philanthropic organizations. And then finally, what are the correct metrics to actually track progress? Some of you have heard that the Great Lakes Commission has been spending an awful lot of giving a lot of attention to weaving our work together under a sort of a rubric where we are making sure it's contributing to regional desired outcomes and being able to track progress on that. So that effort called Blue Accounting has some and efforts underway where we are developing metrics, and we think that a next phase of Erie P Market could contribute to that. So that was the last of it, and there's a link to the ErieP.org where you can actually, if you want to buy a credit or sell a credit, you can download some documents or contact us. And I know Nicole has been the main face with Dan working with many of you the last few months. So thanks for letting me pitch it for Nicole in her absence. And happy to entertain any other questions or comments you might have.
Sarah Rang here. We're involved with the Ontario Federation of Agriculture in a similar program in Ontario looking at edge of field phosphorus reduction. So just wondering if you might be able to comment on, what was the relationship like with the farmers? What was their take-home message in terms of the credit kind of program? Any comments there?
Well, there so we worked with two different producers. One of them, in Ohio, the person we were working with, it was one person who had his family farm, and then he was also renting land. And so he was a very different case than the person we were working with in Lenawee County. In Lenawee County, we were working with a guy who's pretty well known in the area for his kind of demonstration farms, and his personal farm is called like the Center for Excellence, I believe. So his motivation for this was that he was acquiring, he was like an ideal candidate because he had just acquired some new land, and he's somebody who's already well known in the area for championing conservation. And so we got him at the right moment where he happened to have a field where he hadn't already done work on it, which is why he had a favorable outcome. Putting in BMPs for the first time yields a lot more phosphorus reductions than putting in additional BMPs on a field that's already in conservation. So he was very much of that, wanting to be a first mover, was looking for any opportunity to fund further conservation so that he's kind of a community leader. In Ohio, it was not to say that the guy we worked with isn't a community leader, and I would argue that he is for stepping up and working with us, but I think that he was more, he had less public motives in a way, and I think that he was, he wanted to put a buffer strip in on his land and his cover crops, and he had a close relationship with the Soil and Water Conservation District, who were our entryway into these communities. And he was identified to us by the district as somebody who I think, part of it, what they talked about was that NRCS EQIP, I don't know all the details of it, but that funding for certain practices had already been exhausted for the year. So this was somebody who was familiar with ag incentive programs, and I think he saw us as just, an alternative to accomplish this goal that he was already had in mind.
I think I'll just elaborate. Thanks for the question, Sarah. So I think those are detailed responses on how we dealt with two farms. But I think the key takeaway there is we weren't the ones going and knocking on farmer doors, right? So we relied on the county soil and water conservation districts, as I mentioned earlier, that already have existing relationships with these farmers. They're already visiting with them and going to the same professional networks, and they already go and visit their farms. And so we really reached out to them. And from our past work with the ag community, it's really been told to us over and over again that, that's a good way to do things because if, suddenly I start walking onto someone's farm and knock on their door, they're just, who are you and what do you want? And so you really have to work with people who are trusted. So we found that the Soil and Water Conservation Departments are are a key stakeholder group, or if you will, to with trust with many of the farm groups. But your question about sort of their receptivity is another one that, in another project that we're working on, we're looking at it, and there's some work being done by Robin Wilson out of Ohio State University looking at farmer attitudes toward conservation practices and programs. We didn't do that evaluation here, but we are separately doing that, and we'll have some results coming out of that next summer.
Thank you. That's great.
So Sandra Kosick-Sills sent me a text chat, and for those of you who may not be on the text chat or on the webinar, I just want to share Sandra Kosick-Sills is with the Ohio Lake Erie Commission, and she mentioned that the municipal water managers are interested in this type of thing, and in, for example, she brought up Lucas County. And so thank you, Sandra. We will talk with them, but she also recognized that similar challenges with getting ideas to market they're facing in the state of Ohio with their, or the Ohio Lake Erie Commission with their Lake Erie license plate. So you can build a product, but it doesn't mean that people will come. I think many of you who've played in this space have experienced that firsthand. So I think, though, the people who have played in this space, together we can continue to share our best practices and lessons learned. It's very iterative, and hopefully continue to move these ideas forward. Are there other questions, comments, thoughts, feedback? Are there any of you who are on this trading advisory group that would be interested in partnering with us to pursue some of those ideas that we shared on the next steps? We'd probably start having conversations and early to mid 2019. Again, it might depend on program funding, that the opportunities that come our way, but it may also just depend on when we get our ideas solidified. And you don't have to answer out loud. You can email us if you want to.
It's Sarah Rang here. I'd certainly be interested in a further discussion. I need to learn a little bit more, but I'd be very welcoming of a further discussion about it and how it might fit with a couple of programs and ideas that we're working on. So happy to have a further conversation.
Thanks, Sarah. Yeah, and Sarah, you may recall, we recently had a briefing by a gentleman in Canada from a program called ALUS, A-L-U-S, and they're doing ecosystem service marketing on the Canadian side, not just limited to the Great Lakes, but really interesting concept. They're similar but different. So I think there's lots of opportunities to take fresh looks at these mechanisms that we've been able to develop and see apply them in creative contexts.
Yep, I agree. I'm happy to chat further.
Other thoughts? We are early in completing this webinar, but we don't need to keep you on. We can give you back 15 or 45 minutes, depending on how you had it blocked out on your calendar. We originally thought we might take longer, but I hope you found participating on the Trading Advisory Group useful over the past couple of years. And please, if you maybe didn't think about it today, but afterward you're like, oh yeah, I really wish I would have said this, or I wish they would have done that differently, or oh, this has been helpful, we please email Dan, me, or Nicole and share your thoughts. This is a continuing part, even though it's a project that has funding that comes and will end soon. The issue of reducing phosphorus and excessive nutrient loads and other pollutants into the Great Lakes is fundamental to the work that we do, and we will continue to do it. We've been doing it for over 60 years, and we'll keep on at it.
And I would also like to say thank you to everybody for working with us on this project. I've learned a great deal from all of you and just this process, and I really appreciate your input and your time and attention with this. I was going to put 10 exclamation points on the thank you, but I thought that was unprofessional.
All right. Thanks, Dan. Thanks, everyone, for joining the call today. And we'll post the recording and send you the link via email to where it is. Thanks again. Happy holidays, everyone.
Great. Thanks.